Tucson has ignored this decree, destroying nearly 5,000 guns. And not a single funeral was held for any of these firearms. Assistant Attorney General Brun Roydston has threatened to take the matter to the Arizona Supreme Court if Tucson does not comply. Tucson is likely to give in to avoid hefty court fees. So no longer will confiscated guns in Tucson fear having their lives cut tragically short by humans.
What a shame. Well, the good news is a University of Arizona economist says that Tucson's economy should expect to grow faster over the next 2 years. The bad news is that the growth largely depends on Donald Trump's plans, which have proven to be flimsier than his hair in a subtle Irish wind. George Hammond, director of the U of A's Economic and Business Research Center, says that the economy should grow about 1.4% this year and will grow about 2% in 2018. In comparison, Tucson's economy grew about 0.6% last year. Hammond claims that Trump's $1 trillion plan for infrastructure spending will likely spur the economy. Increases in defense spending will also help, with Raytheon, a defense contractor and Tucson's second largest employer, benefiting. The Border Patrol and others involved with border security will also get a boost if Trump's border security plan comes to pass. But keep in mind, these scenarios will only happen if Trump delivers on his promises, which he seems to take as seriously as your alcoholic absentee father telling you he'll beat your game Sunday morning. Keep in mind that if you can also play in the NBA, all you gotta do is try really hard. Hammond did see one weak point in Tucson's economy. He says that there are fewer younger college student graduates compared to those 65 and older. Only 30% of 35 to 44-year-olds have degrees, while only 26% of 25 to 34-year-olds have graduated college. In comparison, 33% of those 65 and older hold a degree. This could be partly due to a brain drain, where college graduates leave the city to find employment somewhere else. Taking a note from Trump, city council members are considering a plan to erect a wall around the city to keep graduates in Tucson.
It looks like it's going to be a cold winter for Tucson's homeless, as 10,000 blankets will not be provided by FEMA. The federal agency who provides supplies for the distressed and disaster-hit areas in the United States usually supplies 10,000 blankets to the Tucson-Pima collaboration to end homelessness. However, this year, areas in the U.S. hit by disasters such as Hurricane Matthew have claimed the blankets. Without special authorization for Congress, the blankets cannot be delivered, and the city is responsible for making up the gap. Officials say that with an administrative change and it being so close to the end of the year, the deliveries are nearly impossible, even with Congress taking action. They are asking the city of Tucson's residents to donate blankets to the city's homeless. Blankets and sleeping bags can be dropped off at any of the city council offices every weekday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Other locations taking blanket donations are the Sacred Heart Church at 601 Fort Low Road, the Salvation Army Hospitality House at 1002 East Main Street, and La Frontera Center at 1101 East Broadway Boulevard. Or you could just hog the blankets for yourself and develop a karmic skin rash in the shape of an accusing finger.
Hopefully you had your pen for that. A pair of Arizona women are suing the state to lower the price of marijuana. Yolanda Daniels and Lisa Becker claim that the state is bogarting money made from medical marijuana licenses. Their lawyer, Steve Smith, says that the state has more than $11 million in surplus cash from the medical marijuana system. The women claim that the state puts an undue burden on residents' healthcare choices, such as Becker, who suffers from a painful autoimmune disease. Currently, licenses run from $150 to $200 for a medical marijuana license. Arizona's Attorney General Mark Brnovich filed a motion to dismiss the case, claiming that the state has full authority to set the price for the licenses. He also said that the women should cut back on the, quote, sticky icky, and go for the lower price schwag if they can't afford that loud.
And I wanted to take a moment to talk about the program you're watching right now. Here at 5 on 20, we're undertaking a new kind of citizen journalism. And we're going to give you the news as we see it. And we want more people to speak up with us. In fact, we need writers, hosts, anchors, camera people, sound people, the whole gamut. The times require a new way of informing ourselves, so join us. Do it, and do it now. email us at info@creativetucson.org to get involved. And if you think there's a story we're missing, a person we should interview, an upcoming event we should cover, or have any kind of news tips, email us at info@creativetucson.org. We're here for you, and we want to cover all stories from all points of view, so don't be strangers.
Please, my hands are sweaty and I'm dying inside.
And now, in national and international news.
Twitter has booted another narc from the party. Media Sonar, a social network surveillance firm, is no longer able to access the geospecific data, which made it so attractive to the law enforcement agencies. The way companies such as Media Sonar work is by searching out dangerous posts and, with Twitter's permission, access the behind-the-scenes information, like where that person commonly tweets from and who they associate with, and sell access to this information to law enforcement. Which is fine if police were searching hashtag I'm going to blow up this building or hashtag I'm a human trafficker. Unfortunately, police are using this powerful tool to monitor hashtags like Black Lives Matter and Justice for Mike Brown. Essentially, law enforcement agencies across the country have been spending millions of dollars to suppress First Amendment rights and be proactively racist. Twitter has also blocked and unfollowed similar companies, Geofedia and SnapTrends. While Twitter may have taken an anti-surveillance stance, other popular social media sites like Facebook, Instagram, and recently on a break after a tough internet relationship, Friendster, have made no such guarantee.
It was all fun and games for Republicans when all they could do was talk about repealing Obamacare. But now that they're in a position to act, the mood is changing. Dismantling the Affordable Care Act and constructing a healthcare system from scratch may take 3 years. This puts Republicans in a difficult position, stuck in the middle between the health insurance industry, which is boasting record profits under Obamacare, and that guy in the American flag t-shirt with the threatening slogan, who thinks Obamacare is socialism. A 3-year reconstruction plan could be dangerous for congressional Republicans in 2018, as all 435 seats in the House of Representatives will be up for election, as well as 8 Republican seats in the Senate. An immediate repeal would be devastating to the 20 million people currently covered under the existing plan. And aside from Trump's assurances that his plan will be bigger, better, and more affordable, no one seems to have any idea what the Republican plan will look like or what we'll call it. Trump care, Trump assurance, Donald care, who knows? And until sanity is restored, or more accurately, established in Washington, we at 5 on 20 encourage our viewers to just avoid getting sick or injured.
Donald care, I like that. Senator leader Mitch McConnell supports an investigation into the possible Russian interference in the 2016 election. McConnell is, so far, the highest-ranked Republican to support the investigation, but is joined by other Republicans such as Marco Rubio and Lindsey Graham expressing support. Arizona Senator John McCain announced that he will also be conducting a second investigation. Over the weekend, CIA officials said they had reason to believe that the Russians actively tried to get Donald Trump elected through hacking activities. The Russians were found to be responsible for hacking the Democratic National Committee during the election. The hacks added to negative sentiment regarding Hillary Clinton and may have influenced the outcome of the election. With his usual contemplative style, Trump responded and, quote, "These are the same people that said Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction." He followed the quote by shooting a pretend basketball into a hoop, then knocked off the hat of a nearby reporter. Trump failed to note that the Saddam issue was from 13 years ago, under completely different leadership. But facts really shouldn't stand in the way of a good burn. Trump followed up his statements on Twitter today. He said, quote, "Unless you catch hackers in the act, it is very hard to determine who was doing the hacking." Not sure why hackers was in quotes. Trump said he would solve the problem by installing cameras in every Russian bedroom, which will capture hackers in the act and also show us the Russian style of masturbating.
Wouldn't that be a sight to see? On Sunday, it was reported that Donald Trump may fill his Secretary of State spot with the boss of the country's largest oil company. Rex Tillerson, CEO of ExxonMobil, is strongly favored to take the spot, which will put him in charge of handling U.S. relations around the world. Trump says that as a head of a huge oil company, Tillerson already negotiates with world leaders and is qualified for the position. But Tillerson has taken fire for his close personal relationship with Vladimir Putin, who, at this rate, will probably be running our country by February. Critics also questioned whether Tillerson can keep the interests of his company apart from the interests of the country. Conflict of interests have been a common theme for this administration, as Trump has come under fire for refusing to remove himself from his business. Oddly enough, the oil executive is the only member of Trump's cabinet so far that believes in man-made climate change. ExxonMobil acknowledged human effects on climate change last year. On their website, they called for effective solutions to combat the problem that they helped cause. Kind of like an arsonist calling for more firefighters.
Mm. Who doesn't love a big oil tycoon? Very trustworthy. Venezuela's government is being accused of being a Grinch this holiday season. The government of Nicolas Maduro is confiscating toys across the country, accusing the sellers of holding onto the toys and selling them at inflated prices. 4.8 million toys were confiscated, according to the government, who were busy racing Slinkies in the lobby. The Venezuelan government says that the toys will be available in the country's poor neighborhoods for lower than market prices. They accused the company, Chrysal, of buying some of the toys back in 2008 and held on to them until prices rose. Venezuela has suffered economic disaster over the past year, with runaway inflation of 500% and massive unemployment. The country is experiencing food shortages, and hospitals often lack medicine and supplies. The government also outlawed the holiday tune Santa Claus is Coming to Town after Santa Claus was banned from Venezuela after bringing a flood of toys last year.
The Chinese government says that they are seriously concerned by comments recently made by President-elect Donald Trump. In an interview on Sunday, Trump said that he sees no reason why the U.S. should adhere to the One China policy that has been followed for the past four decades. The One China policy involves viewing Taiwan, a disputed island, as part of China. Now, this has been a crucial part of our relationship with China, and reneging on the agreement could cost the U.S. billions in trade if China were to cut us off. The issue began when Trump spoke with the Taiwanese government last week, an unprecedented move that critics said could upset our relationship with China. Trump says that he will not accept the One China policy without making a deal with China on the subject of North Korea. Trump claims that the Chinese government supplies North Korea with assistance and keeps the regime of Kim Jong-un running. What he fails to consider is that China may be supporting North Korea because failing to do this could create an unprecedented refugee crisis. We could look at a scenario where North Koreans are flooding into China with potentially no help from the U.S. or any other nations. It could be that China's back is against a wall, and they're not taking it well. An editorial was posted Monday in the Global Times newspaper, which is sanctioned by the Chinese government, and it said that quote, "The One China policy cannot be bought and sold. Trump, it seems, only understands business and believes that everything has a price and that he is strong enough, he can buy and sell it by force." I don't know, but I could have said it better myself.
Agreed. Health officials in the U.S. fear that the rise of e-cigarettes among youth will cancel out the benefits from the decreased number of cigarette smokers in the country. A report released by the Surgeon General was the first to in-depth study e-cigarettes done in the U.S. The report found that young people use e-cigarettes not as a smoking sensation tool, but rather as a potential gateway to cigarettes. E-cigarettes do not contain tobacco, but still contain nicotine, the addictive chemical in cigarettes. Since their rise in popularity, health experts have debated the product, with one side claiming that it's a healthier alternative to cigarettes. The other side says that the science is still inconclusive, and they point to the fact that cigarettes weren't known to be harmful until years after they were introduced into the market. The Surgeon General's report said that e-cigarettes are the most commonly used tobacco product, beating out cigarettes, cigars, hookah. In 2014, the use of e-cigarettes among young adults ages 18 to 24 surpassed those over 25. While adults said they use e-cigarettes to stop smoking cigarettes, young adults listed curiosity as a top reason for trying them. When young adults were surveyed about what they enjoy most about e-cigarettes, the most common response was croaking out sick clouds, bruh, followed closely by steaming some Trill Nick juice.
Researchers in Toronto created a computer algorithm that teaches computers how to write songs. The process, called neural karaoke, uses visual and audio input to teach a computer how to write a song. The researchers said that they hope in the future that the program will be able to create a Spotify or Pandora playlist of songs written on the spot about any topic. With the digital information, the computer can write a simple 120 beat per minute song, then add chords and drums. In their first test, the Toronto researchers, led by Dr. Hang Chu, uploaded 100 Christmas songs and a series of pictures into the computer. Now, if you're a musician who's afraid that the robots might take over your job, don't worry, because this is the song that the computer came up with.
Decorate the room. Christmas tree is filled with flowers. I swear, it is Christmas Eve. I hope that is what you say. The best Christmas present in the world is a blessing. I've always been there for the rest of our lives. 100 and a half hours ago, I am glad to meet you. I can hear the music coming from the hall. A fairy tale, a Christmas tree.
Probably not a chart topper. But the song does evoke the Christmas spirit by reminding us that no matter how bleak things look, there are lots and lots and lots of flowers. At 5 on 20 News, we're starting a contest to see who can write the best Christmas song based on Dr. Chu's creation, which we'll call A Neural Christmas. Send your versions in video or audio form to info@creativetucson.org. And on the show, we'll play the best versions that we receive, because we swear it's Christmas Eve. Well, this was Alex Kack.
And Ty Besh.
For 5 on 20 News. Coming up next, Sean sees dead people.
The closer we come to the negative, to death, the more we blossom. Actor Montgomery Clift said that. And today, on an old Hollywood edition of Sean Sees Dead People, we'll get to know a player of characters, a squashbuckling. He who played Frankenstein, keeping the crowd chuckling. She performed Nefertiti to critics' acclaim, and a woman in noir films, a tough-talking dame. Lights, camera, action. On this day in 1939, actor Douglas Fairbanks died of a heart attack at the age of 56. He was easily one of the biggest stars during the 1910s and 1920s. Soon after arriving in Hollywood, Fairbanks began an affair with America's sweetheart, Miss Mary Pickford. And he was close friends with Charlie Chaplin. By 1918, Fairbanks may have been the most popular actor in the world and the third highest paid, after Chaplin and Pickford, of course. These three, along with director D.W. Griffith, formed the production company United Artists in order to control the production and distribution of their films. Considered everybody's hero and possibly the first action star, Fairbanks acted in such films as The Three Musketeers, The Mark of Zorro, and Robin Hood, always playing the lead and typecast as a swashbuckler. Here's a clip from The Mark of Zorro. So, America's sweetheart, everybody's hero, Hollywood sure liked their labels back then. And on April 30th, 1927, Fairbanks and Pickford placed their hand and footprints in the wet cement at the newly opened Grauman's Chinese Theater in Hollywood. This was the first ceremony of this type. As you probably know, films were silent during the height of Fairbanks' success. So the advent of talkies is what eventually ended his career. And if you've seen Singing in the Rain, then you know what I'm talking about.
And I can't stand him.
On the day of his death, Fairbanks had a mild heart attack. He died in his Santa Monica home later on in that same day. Fairbanks's memorable last words were, "I've never felt better." Since then, a museum was built in his honor in Austin, Texas, and the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences paid tribute to him by naming one of its facilities the Fairbanks Center for Motion Picture Study. So, on this day in 1985, American leading lady Ann Baxter died of a brain aneurysm at the age of 62. Of all the actors who died today in history, Baxter is the only one to have received an Academy Award for her supporting role as Sophie Nelson in The Razor's Edge. She was also nominated for a leading role as Eve Harrington in the unforgettable All About Eve, in which she acted opposite Betty Davis. In this role, she played a conniving understudy, secretly committed to stealing the spotlight from Davis's character. Baxter claims to have modeled the role after an understudy who did sort of the same thing to her. Both Ann Baxter and Betty Davis were nominated for Best Actress of the Year award at the Academy Awards, but neither of them won. Instead, the award went to Vivian Leigh for A Streetcar Named Desire. She did always depend on the kindness of strangers. Baxter is also remembered for her role as Queen Nefertiti in the four-hour biblical epic, The Ten Commandments.
I know you, my sweet. You're a sharp, clawed, treacherous little peacock. But you're food for the gods. And I'm going to have all of you.
None of me. Did you think my kiss was a promise of what you'll have? No, my pompous one. It was to let you know what you will not have.
To start, though. 8 days after, before her death, while hailing a taxi on Madison Avenue in New York City, Ann Baxter collapsed when her brain's function suddenly halted. She spent the rest of her life in New York's Lenox Hospital. Baxter is buried on the estate of Frank Lloyd Wright at Lloyd Jones Cemetery. And on this day in 2006, American comedic actor Peter Boyle died of multiple myeloma, a blood cancer, and he died at the age of 71. While he famously played Ray's dad on Everybody Loves Raymond, for me, his most memorable role was as the monster in Mel Brooks's Young Frankenstein. On October 18th, 2007, which was a year after his death, but happened to be Boyle's birthday, his friend Bruce Springsteen dedicated a song to his memory, during one of his concerts. His wife also established the Peter Boyle Memorial Fund in support of the International Myeloma Foundation.
Good. Good. What is it? What's the matter? Quick, give him the watch.
Three syllables. First syllable sounds like...
Head! Sounds like head! Bed! Said!
Said! Said!
Said! Second syllable, little bird, this, that, the!
Said,
Said,
Dirty word! He said a dirty word!
Sounds like... to give!
Said, said, give! Give him a said a give!
Oh, Tim! Tim! Said a Tim!
On the nosy!
And on this day in 2013, film noir vixen Audrey Totter died from a stroke at the age of 95. She is probably the least known actor of today's segment, but it is understood that her humble career really took off shortly after she signed a 7-year film contract with Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Her first major role in a film was as Jessie Belle Dibson in the daughter, as the daughter in a crime family in Main Street After Dark. And she had success as an actor in noir films and was considered one of the tough-talking dames of the genre. Unfortunately, by the 1950s, the film noir went out of fashion, and so did Totter's career. Here is a brief, tribute to Totter's tough-talking ways in the 1949 film Tension. Totter died 8 days before her 96th birthday, and as was planned, her body was subsequently donated to science at the UCLA Medical School, where her husband, Dr. Leo Fred, had been assistant dean. And that's a wrap.
For all of us here at 5 on 20 News, thank you. We'll see you tomorrow.